So let us start from this example. They are saying that the box weighs 60 newtons. Determine the maximum and minimum pressures it exerts on the ground. The maximum and minimum pressures it exerts on the ground. So on that box, there are sides that give us maximum area, and there are also sides that will give us a minimum area. So we have to calculate every side and see which side has the largest area. The side that has the largest area is the one we shall use to determine the minimum pressure. If the area is large or maximum, we shall use it to find the minimum pressure. So we are going to calculate each side and we find which side has the maximum area and also which side has the largest, I mean which side has the largest area and also which side has the smallest area. So allow me, let me first draw this diagram there and show you. So I'm drawing as you also draw. I hope so. So there is that box which is there, and this is, and this is 1 meter, 2 meters, and 3 meters. So there are different faces which are there. Let me try to zoom in there for you very well, and you see there are different faces. So we have this face here. Let me start with this one here. Let me shade it. Are you seeing it? So that is a box. We can decide to put this box. Suppose it's like this book here. Let me zoom in there very well and you see. So if this is the box, it has this area here. It has this area. And it also has this area. So there are three faces. This face, this one here, this one here, and also this one here, this one. So the box can sit like this, or it can sit like this, or it can even sit like this. So at every side, there will be a different pressure that will be exerted due to the area of that side. So when you look at this side, the area is different compared to the area of this. So here the area is large. Here the area may be small, and this area may be, this one here may be the smallest here. So at every side, we have different areas, meaning that we shall have different pressures that will be exerted. So this is the box having different sides or different faces. So this face here, if this is 1 meter, and it means that also this is 1 meter here, this is also 1 meter here. So it means that we have a rectangle which is here. So let me call this face, let me call it
maybe let me call it B, this one, let me call it B. So the area of B is given by, this is now a rectangle, isn't it? So it is given by the length times the width.
It's given by the length times the width. I'm saying that this face here is in form of a rectangle. So it is given by the length times the width So our width here, our width is 1 meter and our length is 3 meters. So area of B is 3 times 1, and we shall get 3 meters squared. That is the area of B. So this is the area for this face. So we are going to determine the area of another face. Let us look at this face here, this one here, this one, that one there. So that face there, let me try to zoom in there and you see it well. We are looking at this one. So let me call this one C, call it C. So area of C is also given by, now this is in form of also a rectangle. So this is the length and this is the width. So we have length times width. Length times width. So we shall have the length, which is 2 meters, then times 1 meter, and we shall get 2 meters squared. So this face here gives us 2 meters squared, whereas this one here was giving us 3 meters squared. Now, there is another one. This bigger one here, are you seeing this bigger one here? So the bigger one, I'm not going to shade it, but let me call it maybe D, this one here, this bigger one, this one, none which is unshaded. So we know that if this is 3 meters, this is also 3 meters, also this one is 3 meters. So here we have 3 meters, and this is, if this is 2 meters, this is also 2 meters, and also this one is 2 meters. So here we have 2 meters. So the unshaded, this one, which is unshaded, this one here, this face here, which is unshaded, what is its area? So let me find the area of D. Area of D is given by the length times the width, So, How do we get the area? So we shall substitute the length. The length is 3. So we shall write 3 meters, then times the width, which is 2 meters. And our answer becomes 60 meters squared. So it means that on these three faces, this one, and this one, C, B, and D, one of them has the smallest area and another one has a maximum area. One of them has a minimum area and another one has a maximum area. So the box for it to stand on the ground, these areas are the ones that we shall use to find either the minimum pressure or the maximum pressure. So we have seen that this now, when you look here, we have seen that area C, this one here, is the one that gives us a maximum. So this one is the maximum, is the minimum, not the minimum area. So there we have the minimum area. And this one gives us the maximum area. Are we together? That gives us the maximum area. So if we are told to find the pressure, now we go back to our question. Our question is saying that the box weighs 60 newtons. So it means that the weight, which is 60 newtons, is the same as the force. So it means that our force is 60 newtons. Because how do we define weight? You say that weight is the force of gravity. It is a force of gravity acting on a body. So weight is a force. That means that our force is 60 newtons. So if we are told to find the minimum, let us start with a minimum pressure. Minimum pressure, we shall say minimum pressure is equal to force divided by the area, but the area, if here I have minimum, here the area must be maximum area. Mm-hmm. So we substitute, our force is 60 newtons divided by the area that is maximum, and the maximum area is 60 meters squared. So divide by 6 meters squared, and that gives us, what do we get? We get
10.
We get 10. 10 what? 10 cows? What do we get? 10. What are the units?
Newtons per meter.
Hey, hey. So if you don't know meters,
newtons per meter squared,
newtons per meter squared, you can say 10 per pascals. Are we together? 10 per pascals. 10 pascals. Or you can write 10 newtons per meters squared. Okay. So how do we find now the maximum pressure? The maximum pressure is given by the force divided by the minimum area. Divided by the minimum area. So the force will remain as 60, but our minimum area was 2 meters squared. Sorry, 2 meters squared. So we shall write 2 meters squared. And once you divide 60 by 2, you get the 30. So this was 10. Yeah, you get 30 pascals. Or you can write 30 newtons per meter squared. So you can see that 30 is greater than 10. So 30 corresponds to maximum pressure, and 10 corresponds to minimum pressure. Is it okay, members? Is it okay?
Yes.
All right. So
yes, teacher.
I don't know what's happening. Some people are going and then coming back, going and then coming back. I don't know what they are doing.
Network.
Network problem.
Yes.
Yes.
So let us look at example 2. Are you seeing the notes very well? Members, are you seeing the notes clearly?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so let us look at example 2. Example 2, they are saying that a box of dimensions, this and this, weighs 30 kilograms. Determine the maximum and the minimum pressures exerted by the box on the ground. So there we have a box. I will not redraw it again, but we have the box there. So from there, someone can tell me what is the, who can give us the maximum area? The maximum area. The maximum area. The maximum area. How shall we get to the maximum area? The largest area. Elizabeth, how can we get to the maximum area? What are we going to multiply with?
Well, before multiplying, we'll have to first change the 20 centimeters and 10 centimeters.
So you are going to first try out different sides, isn't it?
Yes.
So we shall first try the first one. We are going to first try this one here of 20 and 10. So we have 10 times 20, and we shall get 200 centimeters squared. Mm-hmm. We have another one at the bottom, 20 and 1. 20 and 1, this bigger one here at the bottom. So we have 20 times 1. But the one which is there is of 1 meter. Are you seeing that?
Yes.
It is of 1 meter. So they must be in the same units.
Units.
Mm-hmm. So what we are going to do is that we are going to convert the 20 into meters. And we shall divide it by 100.
Good.
Are we together? 100. So 20 divided by 100, you get 0.2 meters, isn't it? So 0.2 times meters. 1. And you get 0.2 meters squared. Isn't it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So we have another face. We had two faces. The first one was this. Let me first draw it here. The first one was this, which was 10 centimeters and 20 centimeters. Members, it is also important to first change them into meters, because it is sometimes very hard for us to change 200 centimeters into meters squared. So it's better we first change these ones into meters. So when you change that 10 into meters, you get, divide by 100, and you get 0.1 meter. Are we together? If you change 20 into meters, divide by 100, and you get 0.2. So if you want to get now the area of this, the area is going to be length times width, and we are going to get 0.2 times 0.1. And what do you get if you multiply 0.2 times 0.1? You get
0.02 meters squared.
So that was the first phase. And then the second face is that downer one there, which is like that, which is like this, dotted there inside, like that. Yeah. So we have the one which is inside there. I've drawn it, I think, wrongly. So let me draw it like this. And then there like that. Okay, so here it is 1 meter, and here it is. By this one, we have found it is here. So this one is the same as 0.2 meters. So it means that its area is length times width, which is 0.2 times 1, and we got 0.2 meters squared. So there is another one. Are you seeing this one here? Of 1 meter and 10. So there is another one, which looks like this. So it is 1 meter, and here it is 10, but 10 divided by 100, we get 0.1 meter, isn't it? So its area is length times width. This was 10 here, this 10 which is here, is the same as the one which is here. So I'm using this face here, this one, this face. So here it is 10, but that 10 is the same as 0.1 meter. So, and 1. So we have 0.1 times 1, and you get 0.1 meter squared. Okay, so we have got 3. We have this area, we have this area, we have this area. So one of them should give us the maximum pressure. But when you go back to the question, they are telling us that this body weighs 30 kilograms. So the weight is not given. They have given us the mass, which is equal to, the mass is equal to 30 kilograms.
Okay. So
we have to find the weight. How do you find weight? Weight is equal to?
Mg.
Mg. Mass times?
Acceleration.
Acceleration due to gravity. So we shall have 30 times 10. Because the acceleration due to gravity is 10 meters per second squared. So 30 kilograms times 10, and we get 300 newtons. So therefore, it means that our force is equal to 300 newtons. So we have this area, we have this area, and we have also this area. So those three areas, one of them is maximum and the other is minimum. Which one is maximum? Fiona, which one is maximum? Mungulu Fiona, which one is maximum? Okay, just taking over. I could not now put you in groups because you people, you go off and you come back. You go off and come back. I don't know. If I put you in groups, you disappear and come back, disappear. So this is the maximum. Let me see, this is 0.02. This is 0.2, this is 0.1. Which one is high? Which one is high?
0.2.
Yes. 0.2. Is the maximum, isn't it? This is the maximum area. Okay. And which one is the smallest?
I think
0.02. So this one is the this one is the minimum area. Okay, so we can find, we can proceed from there and find maximum pressure is equal to force over minimum area. So the force is 300 tons divided by the minimum area. Minimum area is 0.02. So this is newtons, this is meters squared. And what do we get? What do we get when you divide there?
15,000.
You get 15 what?
1,000.
15,000 pascals. Are we together? 15,000 pascals. And to get to the minimum pressure, we shall have force divided by the area that is maximum. Area that is maximum. So the force is 300 newtons divided by the area that is maximum is 0.2 meters squared. And what's our answer there?
1,500
pascal. Okay. Hope you have understood the minimum and the maximum pressure, isn't it?
Yes.
So there is this example here. It's almost similar to what we have done. You can go through it. We are left with 7 minutes. 7 minutes. Now, the exercise that I'm going to give you, members, we have two questions here. explain the following observations. A large reservoir is much wider at the base than at the top. Do you know a water reservoir? The water tank?
Yes.
So even dams, they are made in a way that they are large at the base than at the top. What can be the reason to that? So this question, I want you to go and research about it, so that when you come back, we look at pressure in fluids. Fluids, we are talking about air and liquids. So this question requires you to have knowledge about pressure in fluids, and also this one here. But number two is the exercise that I want you to do. Are you seeing number two?
Yes.
Okay, you do for me that exercise. And next time you shall come and study pressure in fluids. But there's something that I want to note about. Let me see this example. They are saying that dimensions of a cuboid are 5 centimeters, 10 centimeters, and 20 centimeters. And the mass of the cuboid is 6 kilograms. Calculate the maximum and the minimum pressure of the cuboid exerts on the ground. This is what we have looked at, isn't it? So you need to change the mass into weight and find it in newtons. Then you calculate out the maximum area and also the minimum area. It's what we have looked at. Then there is a certain part. Now they are saying that when half filled with water, suppose this is half filled with water, this one, if it is half filled with water, so it means that here the height, if you fill this cuboid with water, it means that the height will be 2.5 centimeters instead of 5. So it will be 2.5 centimeters. So in that case, we shall be using a height of 2.5 centimeters.
Mm-hmm.
2.5 centimeters. And now when we want to find the force exerted by this box, we shall get the mass of the cuboid, we find its weight. We shall also get the volume of the water inside, times the density of the water, and we find the mass of that water. Then we find the force of that water. So when we come back, members, are we together?
Yes.
Come back. We shall start with this example here because we have a limited time. This time may not be enough for us to finish this whole example. We shall start with this example here, and I will elaborate more when it comes to half filled with water. Why do they calculate the mass of that water and the mass of the box and they add it together? So I will show you that. Now, there are things here that I can explain in these 3 minutes for you to know. So they're saying that when calculating pressure, the unit of area of the base is always meter squared. We have seen that. So from the calculations that we have done, the greater the area over which the force acts normally, the less the pressure. So it means that if the area increases, then the pressure reduces. If the area reduces, then the pressure increases. So this is what we are talking about. Pressure area reduces, the pressure increases. And if the area increases, the pressure reduces. So they are saying that note, a tractor with wide wheels can pass over soft ground because
was even outside my yes.
Mm-hmm. A tractor with wider wheels can pass over soft ground because the greater area of the wider wheel exerts less pressure. You have seen tractors, they have big tires. Why do they have big tires? So that they exert less pressure.
Pressure.
If those tires were made small, like the ones of a wheelbarrow, the tractor would have sucked inside the soil. Are we together? So what they do, they use big tires such that the big tires exert pressure on the ground because tractors move in muddy places. So they don't want that tractor to get stuck. A hippopotamus of wider feet is able to walk on soft grounds without sinking because the greater area of wide hooves exerts less pressure. So these hooves, let me say the feet for the hippopotamus, they are hooves. So those hooves have a wider area and they exert a less pressure. And lastly, when the same force is applied on the needle and the nail, both placed on the hand, one tends to feel more pain from the needle because the needle has a small area that exerts a greater pressure. So the needle has the smallest area and that's why it exerts a greater pressure. And lastly, a sharp knife cuts well because than a blunt one because a sharp knife has a small area than a blunt knife. So you do for me this exercise too and you post it on WhatsApp on my number